I'm thankful for every one of you who are watching online. Though we are not able to meet together as a church family, we still are gathering in homes. In fact, let me broaden your perspective just for a second. Over the last several weeks, we've had more people who've participated in our weekend worship services than we've ever had people on our campus before. It's been amazing. In fact, we have four campuses. We have the Bonnie Oaks campus and Creekside and North Ottawa and St. Elmo campus. But over the last several weeks, we've added several thousand more campuses. Why? Because your home has now become an extension of our church. Your home has always been a shelter, but now it's become a sanctuary. And I love seeing all your social media posts of you and your family worshiping online. And what we're going to do today is we're going to take communion together. Together as a church, but together as a family. And I hope that already in your homes, you have prepared yourself. You have some bread, you have some juice, because at the very end of my message today, we're actually going to take communion together. Now, in preparation for communion, I want us to study a couple of passages, first in Mark chapter 14, and then in Psalm 118. Notice what the Word of God says when Jesus instituted communion. It says this in Mark chapter 14, verse 22. It says, as they were eating, he took bread, blessed and broke it, gave it to them and said, this, take it, this is my body. Then he took a cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them, and they all drank from it. He said to them, this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. Truly, I tell you, I will no longer drink of the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God. Now, verse 26 is critical. After singing a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. Did you hear that? That here, at the very end, Jesus says, let's sing a song together. They sang together. I mean, think about that. Jesus has just explained that the body, his body is going to be broken for them. His blood is going to be shed for them. And now he's going to sing a song. Remember, this is the Last Supper. This is his final farewell meal with his disciples. Jesus, before he was betrayed, before he was arrested, he's about to endure a shameful trial. He's about to be humiliated. He's going to experience the darkest moment in human history. And yet, before he faces all of that, he does what? He sings a song. And I don't know about you, but that's remarkable to me. In fact, think of it like this. Imagine that if tonight at 10 o'clock, you knew that you were about to be betrayed by a friend and then falsely accused and arrested, and then you'd be humiliated and beaten beyond recognition and then nailed and crucified and die tomorrow. Do you think at 10 o'clock you'd be singing some songs? I doubt it. You see, most of us, what do? We sing whenever we're marching toward our joys. Jesus is singing as he's marching to the cross. Most of us, we lift up our joyful voices whenever there's some honor that's awaiting us. Jesus lifted up a melody whenever shame and pain awaited him. And there's a principle here. It's very simple. By following Jesus' example, we can sing in our nights. We can actually have a song in our night. That's why I've entitled today's sermon, A Song in the Night. How do we do that? Well, we know what Jesus' final song was. Based on Jewish rabbinical writings, we know that during the Passover, they sang the Hallel. That is Psalms 113 through Psalm 118. And the very final song that they would sing is Psalm 118. And so what is it that Jesus sang before his crucifixion, before his humiliation, before his betrayal, before the trial, before all the things that he was about to endure? What was on Jesus' mouth, his lips, his mind? It was Psalm 118. And these truths that we're going to study from Psalm 118 will enable Jesus to have a song in the night. And these same truths will enable you to have a song in the night as well. There are three truths, and I encourage you to write them down. The very first one is going to be taught by Randy Thomas, our campus pastor of North Ottawa.
So as we look at Psalm 118, we're going to see the confessions that Jesus made, and especially that he made in regards to his heavenly Father. So the first one that I want you to notice, the first confession that Jesus made, is that God is good. That's number one. God is good. Now, that's difficult for us to understand, believe, comprehend sometimes when difficult things are happening, but God is good. Notice what David said in Psalm 118, verse number one. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his loving kindness is everlasting. Now, when things are going well and everything's like it should be and we're happy and healthy, it's easy for us to make the declaration that God is good all the time. I got a promotion at work and I say, wow, God is good. Look at what God did. God is so good. The doctor tells me that the cancer is in remission. Wow, God is so good. And it's easy to proclaim that then. We got an offer on our house finally. Yes, God knew we were struggling financially and he's so good. And it's easy to make those kinds of declarations when things are going well. But what about when circumstances are not good? Is God still good then? What do we have a tendency to say when bad things happen? Well, I lost my job, got laid off at work. Does God not even care what's going on in my life? The doctor said that the chemo is not working. I guess God's not even listening to our prayers. We still don't have an offer on our house. Does God know that we're struggling and suffering financially right now? And that's where we tend to go sometimes. You see, the significance of God's goodness is that he is always good, even when what's happening around me doesn't seem to be good. What happens is bad things seem to come our way. Bad things happen, and then the evil one begins to whisper things into our ear. He'll say things like this: God must have forgotten you. God really can't be trusted. Look what you're going through. God isn't good after all, is he? His words can't be trusted. Look at the mess that you're in. That was exactly what happened with Adam and Eve all the way back in the Garden of Eden. In Genesis chapter 3, the evil one comes to Adam and Eve and he begins to place those questions of doubt about God's goodness in their minds. In Genesis chapter 3, Satan says this: did God really say you must not eat the fruit from any of the trees in the garden? What was he doing? He was trying to get them to question God's word. Did God really say this? Is that what God said? You might want to question that. Later on in the same chapter, Satan said, you'll not surely die, for God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be open and you will be like God. What was he trying to do there? He was trying to get them to question God's trustworthiness. Is God trustworthy? Question his word. Question his trustworthiness. And those were the things that Satan does. He did to them and he does to us. He wants us to focus on our circumstances and our surroundings rather than focus on the God who's in control of our circumstances and surroundings. You see, if we're not careful, we'll begin to equate good things happening in our life with God being happy and pleased with us and bad things happening with God being unhappy with us. But the proof of God's goodness is not that everything in my life is perfect, but that despite the difficulties and the challenges and the troubles and the trials and the griefs that we go through, that God is determined to use all of those things for our good and his glory. Very familiar passage of scripture is Romans chapter 8. And in verse number 28, it says this: and we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him, who've been called according to his purpose. We as humans have determined in our minds what things are good and what things are bad. And then when God brings something into our lives that doesn't fit that narrative, we begin to question him. God, what are you doing? I don't understand this. This doesn't fit how I think it should. St. Augustine said this, and just such a powerful quote. He said, God is always trying to give good things to us, but our hands are too full to receive them. I believe with all my heart that during these times of uncertainty, that God is trying to help us empty our hands. He's trying to get us to empty our hands of all the things that we've been holding on to and grasping on to and trusting in and saying, let go of those things and see and experience and be able to receive. My goodness. Let me also say this. God is good. And that's not just describing what he does. It's who he is. And who he is never changes. God's nature, his very nature, is good. The psalmist David said in Psalm 34, verse number 8, "Taste and see that the Lord is good. How happy is the man who takes refuge in him." Now, David doesn't say that God does good things. He says that he is good. It's his very nature. I remember as a kid, one of the choruses that we would sing in church, very profound words, but very simple words, was just that God is good. God is so good. God is so good. He's so good to me. Now, when we go through our dark times, declaring songs like that and declaring that God is good does several things for us. And I want you to see that very quickly. When we declare that God is good during our difficult times, it gives us peace and it gives us encouragement. When I'm going through a difficult time, to declare, God, you're good. God, you are good. Even when I don't see it, even when I don't understand it, even when everything around me doesn't seem to be good, I declare, God, you are good. It brings peace and it brings encouragement to me. Psalm 52:1 says, "The goodness of God endures continually." So declaring that God is good gives peace and encouragement. It also does this. It assures us that God's purposes for us are good as well. It's not always easy to see that. It's not always easy to navigate it. But when I declare, God, I believe that you are good, it reassures my heart, it reassures my mind that God's purposes for me are good. James 1:17 says, "Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above." But then finally, during difficult times, when I declare that God is good, it gives me a perfect model of goodness to others. You see, when I'm going through a tough time, when I'm going through difficulty, when I'm going through stress or whatever it is, I'm not always a great person to be around. I'm not always a person that does good and acts in good ways. But we have a Heavenly Father that treats us good during our difficult times, and that is a perfect model for us of how we're to treat others. Psalm 119:68 says, "You're good and do only good. Teach me your decrees." What was David saying? God, you do good and you do only good, so teach me how to do that as well. So right now, wherever you are, when you're watching this, wherever you are from, wherever you're sitting, standing, wherever, I want you to do this. I want you to declare that with me. I want us to say it out loud that God is good. Here we go. Say it with me. God is good.
So we saw in verse 1 that God is good. It's one of his attributes. God cannot be anything other than good. But not only is God good, in verses 5 through 8, we're going to also see that God is with me. God is with me. Specifically, God is with those whom he has saved and whom God the Spirit indwells. Let's look at verse 5. Let's just kind of go through it. Let me just read it. Here's what the psalmist says. "Out of my distress, I called on the Lord. The Lord answered me and set me free." And there's a picture here being painted by the psalmist. It's a picture of a person in great distress. They're pressed in on all sides, and there seems to be no way out. And I imagine that we have all been there. Maybe you're there even right now. You are in great distress. There seems to be no way out at all. And so the question is, when you're in that situation, what do? Right? How do you handle those situations? Well, what did the psalmist do? Well, the psalmist only does one thing. It says, called on the Lord. Notice, he did not call on pop culture or pop psychology or the wisdom of man. He called on, it says he cried out to, the only thing that has the ability to deliver him, the living God. And notice how the living God responds. The living God responds in two ways. It's in the text. First way, the text says, "The Lord answered me," right? So he's in distress. He cries out to God. the Lord answered him. Like God's not far and removed and ignoring the cry, he answered him. But not only does he answer him, God does a second thing. The text says, set me free. Set him free. That's the very thing that he needed, to be set free. So he goes from distress to freedom by doing one thing, calling on the living God. So what can we learn from this? What can we learn from this? That if you are in distress, call on the living God. And that's what he did, and I believe that's what you and I should do as well. And then we get to verse 6, and we're going to see that the psalmist reaches some conclusions based upon the fact that when he was in distress, God heard him and set him free. Here's what he concludes, verse 6. The Lord is on my side, statement, that's a statement. I will not fear, that's a statement. And now he's going to ask a question. What can man do to me? All right, two statements and a question. But I want to briefly talk about the question, because I think it's an interesting question. It's a rhetorical question, meaning the answer to the question is found within the question. So the answer to the question is supposed to be nothing. That's what it's supposed to be. If you grew up in church, you know that's the right answer, right? If God is with me, what can man do to me? That's supposed to be the answer. But I don't know. I can't help but think when I read that, what can man do to me? I don't know. Man can do a lot to me, right? Even if God is with you, the Bible testifies that man can do a lot to you. I mean, I think about the Apostle Paul. The Apostle Paul, God was with him for sure, without a doubt. But man did a lot to him. Paul says he was in prison, faced death 5 times, received 40 stripes minus 1, 3 times, beaten with rods. Once he was stoned. Paul says he was in peril from robbers, in peril in the country, in peril from Gentiles in the city. He was hungry, he was thirsty, often cold, without clothing. So it appears that even though God was with him, man could do a lot to him. So here's my question. If I was to ask the psalmist, what do you mean by that? What do you mean, what can man do to me if God is with me? What can we make of it? Well, I think all scripture would testify to this one fact. Ultimately, for the man or woman who is born again, man cannot do something to you eternally, meaning forever, right? I mean, they can do things on this side of heaven. There's no doubt on this side of heaven. But eternally, they can't do anything because God holds us. No one can touch what God has prepared or has in store for those whom he loves, those whom he has saved, all right? And knowing that, knowing, hey, listen, on this side of heaven, yeah, man, I get it. We can be harmed by man, but ultimately and eternally, no one can harm us, not our eternity, not our security. We can say the same statements that the psalmist said. The Lord is on my side. I'm not going to fear. I'm not going to fear. And after saying the two statements and the question, we roll into verse 7. He's going to say two additional things. Here's what he says. The Lord is on my side as my helper. I shall look in triumph on those who hate me. Two additional statements there. Real quick, on my side does not mean God lives for your glory or that God is going to jump through your hoops. That's not what it means. On my side means that there is a personal relationship between the psalmist and the living God. He is in a right relationship with the living God by grace through faith. And there are benefits to being in a right relationship with the living God. One is that God is your helper. He is. If you're a born-again man or woman, the living God is your helper. But hey, real quick, it's not a helper to get a bigger house. It's not a helper to get a nicer car. It's a helper in your personal holiness. That's what we need, right? That's what we need, to become more and more like Jesus. And that leads us to verse 8, where the psalmist reaches one overarching conclusion. He was in distress. He cried out to the Lord. The Lord heard him, set him free. Here's his final conclusion, verse 8. it is better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in man. I say, amen, man, right on. When in distress, you call on the Lord, and what does he do? He hears, he sets free. So ultimately, what can man do to you? Ultimately, nothing. Because of grace, the born again man or woman has a right relationship with God, and there is no safer place to be. There is no safer place to be. So remember, not only is God good, that's an attribute of God. He cannot not be good, but he's also with you. He's with you for his glory and for your good.
So how did Jesus sing his song in the night? Well, he first of all remembered that God is good. He remembered that God was with him, but there's a third truth, and I want you to jot it down. The third truth is this: God will prevail. God will prevail. No matter how dark your night may become, God wins. Look at some of the last verses in Psalm 118. Look at Psalm 118, verse 13. It says this: they pushed me hard to make me fall, but the Lord helped me. I mean, that reminds me of Jesus carrying his cross, and they pushed him, and he fell to the pavement. And in Jesus' mind, he's just saying, the Lord's going to give me strength. The Lord's going to lift me up. The Lord's going to help me in this moment. Look at the next verse, verse 14. The Lord is my strength and my song. He's become my salvation, my victory. There are shouts of joy and victory in the tents of the righteous. I mean, I can just imagine Jesus thinking, you know what? You can knock me down, but you're not going to knock me out. Why? Because God's going to get the ultimate victory here. Look down at verse 17. It's amazing. Jesus says and saying, I will not die, but I will live and proclaim what the Lord has done. Over and over again, Jesus predicted. He predicted his death, but then he predicted his resurrection. And here he's saying it. He says, one day, I'm going to still live, and I'm going to proclaim what the Lord has done. Now look at verse 22. The stone that the builders rejected became the cornerstone. Think about it. These religious leaders, they have rejected their Messiah, Jesus Christ. And now Jesus Christ has become the cornerstone of salvation for all of humanity. Jesus sang this song, and just a few hours later, he was like a lamb silent before his accusers. And you know what they did? They falsely accused Christ, and then they blindfolded him. And then what do? They slapped Jesus. They'd say, Jesus, you claim to be a prophet. Tell us who's hitting you. Can you imagine the mockery in that moment? And with every slap of rejection, Jesus recalled to his mind, you're rejecting me, but I'm going to become the cornerstone. But now look at the next verse, verse 23. This came from the Lord, and it's marvelous in our sight. This is the day the Lord's made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Jesus is confessing that all of this, even the pain, even the rejection, it's all from the Lord. And because he knows it's all from the Lord, he can say, in this pain of rejection, in this dark night of the soul, this is the day the Lord's made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. And it's the very same thing for you. You see, you're going to have dark moments, painful times. And what are you going to do? You got to face it the same way Jesus did. Jesus promised this. Jesus said, in this world, you will have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I've overcome this world. And in your dark moments, in those hours of darkness, in your nights when you just want to give up, in those times, what you do, you press into Christ. And what do? You remember, God's going to win this thing, and he will. In fact, did you know that's how Jesus Christ endured the pain of the cross? The writer of Hebrews gives us this perspective of what Jesus was thinking when he was suffering. Look at what it says in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2. It says this: Jesus, who for the joy that was set before him, endured the cross, despising the shame. See, Jesus endured the pain of the cross and his suffering. How? By keeping his mind and his focus where? On Sunday, his resurrection. And it's the very same thing for you. Whenever you're going through your difficult seasons of life and you're going through the Fridays of your life, you need to keep your mind focused on the victory that's going to come. Keep your focus on Sunday. Like that old African-American pastor once put it, he says, it's Friday, but Sunday's coming. It's Friday, but Sunday is coming. And so today, before we take communion, I do want us to remember Jesus is Friday. I mean, Jesus was like a lamb led to the slaughter, and he was silent before his accusers. And then they beat him and slapped him and plucked his beard and spit upon him. And then what did the Roman soldiers do? They took a cat of nine tails and they beat Jesus beyond recognition. And then after they beat him, they took a crown of thorns and they pressed it into his scalp. And then they put a cross on his back and made him carry it through the streets of Jerusalem. And then whenever they got up to the place of the skull, they laid Jesus down on that cross and they took nails and they drove those nails into his hands and into his feet. And there our Savior and Lord was, hanging between heaven and earth. But the most painful moment had not yet come, because the Bible says at high noon, something supernatural happened. All the earth became dark. And in that moment, all the sin of all of humanity was placed on Christ. That Jesus bore our sins. He who knew no sin became sin for us. And in that moment, Jesus cries out, what? It is finished, paid in full. Jesus Christ endured his Friday. Why? Because he kept his mind focused on the Sunday that's coming. God is going to win this victory. And it's the very same thing for you. Right now, you may feel like you're in a Friday. It feels like Friday because I can't pay the bills. It's Friday and I've been laid off because of this virus. It's Friday and the marriage is struggling. It's Friday and the kids are going astray. It's Friday and the cancer is returned. I know it's Friday, but Sunday's coming, folks. Sunday's coming. Because Jesus Christ endured the dark hour of his soul for every one of us on the cross, now you as a child of God, you can have a song in your night. That no matter how dark your hour becomes, the voice and the song of Jesus can shine through and you can sing in the middle of your darkest hours. That's what Christ has enabled you to do. Why? Because we're singing the same song he sings. Same truth. Because God is good and God is with you and God wins. You can sing a song in your night. So child of God, sing your song. Sing your song. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for giving us the example of Jesus Christ, our Lord, our Master, and we've chosen to follow him. And so, Lord, just as Jesus endured his Fridays by looking at Sunday, Lord, help us to do the same thing. And Lord, even now, as we take communion together, I'm asking in Jesus' name that you truly do commune with us in this hour and in this moment. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. What I'd like for you to do now is prepare yourself to take communion. Hopefully, all of you in your homes already have the bread and the juice. If you could go ahead and distribute the bread and the juice to everybody that's going to be participating in communion today. And just hang on to that, because we need to go through a little examination. The Bible says that before we are to take communion, we need to have a personal evaluation and examination. Notice how the Apostle Paul put this in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 27. Paul wrote, "Whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the sin against the body and the blood of the Lord. So let a person examine himself." You see, we are not to take communion flippantly. No, we are to recall in our mind that this represents the body of Christ and the blood of Christ. So we should enter into this moment reverently. And so I want to encourage you to examine yourself in two ways. The first, examine whether you're truly in the faith. Examine if you are truly a follower of Jesus Christ. You may have head knowledge, but you don't have a heart relationship with God. You see, this is a covenant meal. It is for those individuals that have a true relationship with Christ. If you're not truly a follower of Christ, then bow your head, humble your heart, and call on Jesus to become your Lord. You can do that right now. But those of you that are here that you know you are a follower of Christ, the second examination is this. Has your heart drifted away? That maybe, you know, your heart is not really passionate following after Jesus like you know it once was or like it should be. Other things have taken Christ's place. Other priorities have gotten in the way. And if that's you, I'm asking you to repent. to turn from that sin, to turn from those priorities, and return to Jesus Christ. And so what I'd like for you to do, in a moment of evaluation, I want every one of us to bow our heads and close our eyes. And in just a moment here, I'm going to allow you to do business with God and repent of your sins and renew your vows and commitment to Him. Before we take communion, take this moment right now and draw close to the Lord. Will you pray with me right now? I'm going to pray out loud, but would you pray from your heart, just right where you're at? Would you pray something like this? Dear Lord, thank you for your sacrificial love. I believe that you died for my sins. I believe that your blood was shed so that I could be forgiven and healed. Thank you for your grace. I repent of my sin and selfishness. I turn from my wayward heart and I return back to you. Please forgive me. I renew my relationship with you, Lord God. Thank you for hearing my prayer. I choose now to commune with you. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Now, if you've gone through that personal examination, you're now ready to take communion. And we start with the bread. Jesus took bread that night of Passover and he gave it to his disciples and he broke it and he said, "This is my body which is broken for you. Take in remembrance of me." Take in remembrance of Christ now. Let's pray. Father, thank you for sending your son. Lord Jesus, thank you for giving your self, your body to be broken. We were broken to be healed. And so I'm asking in the name and authority of Jesus Christ that you would heal. You would heal hearts. You would heal lives and marriages, spiritually, physically, emotionally, relationally. Oh God, right now as we commune with you, would you please heal us? We pray this for your glory in Jesus' name. Amen. And then Jesus took the cup, symbolizing his blood. And he said, "This is the blood of the new covenant shed for you. Take and drink in remembrance of Christ. Drink now." Let's again pray. Lord Jesus, thank you. Thank you for shedding your blood for our sins. And we know that your blood is enough, that it is sufficient to forgive us and heal us and cleanse us. And Lord, you wash us whiter than snow. So thank you for the forgiveness that we have through your blood. We love you, Lord, and bless you now. In Jesus' name, amen.